My name is Wei Jima. I'm a professor in psychology as well as in neuroscience. And this is a much less fancy presentation of my lab. It's just a screenshot from a Zoom lab meeting that we had recently. My lab studies three different areas, if you want. So one is how people make decisions under uncertainty. The second one is working memory and attention. And the third one is planning. And I'm mostly going to talk about the third one. I'm only going to talk about the third one and the rest, because that's sort of our focus in recent years. So some of you might have seen that a lot of exciting news from computers being able to play complex games such as chess or shogi or go. Much of that is coming from DeepMind. And these are deep neural networks that can solve planning problems that are really complicated, and they do that at levels that are often way beyond what people can do. And so that's very impressive. But what you can ask is, do we really understand how people solve such complex planning problems? And people plan all the time, right? Not just in games, but also if you're trying to get from A to B, or if you're doing career planning, or even if you're writing or programming, those are all planning problems. And people are pretty good at those, right? But we don't really understand the processes that go into how humans plan. So in spite of there being a lot going on in computer science, the psychology of planning is a little bit lagging behind. So what we do in the lab is we study this using simple games. So this is just like tic-tac-toe, except that it's on a bigger board and you have to make four in a row rather than three in a row. Okay, the rules are otherwise exactly the same as in tic-tac-toe. So that means that if you bring people to the lab, they can pretty much immediately play this because it's a very simple instruction. By the way, this is different from Connect Four, right? Because in Connect Four, the pieces actually drop to the bottom. Here, you can just place them anywhere. Now, what you see here in the movie is a game between two players who have never seen this game before. So what you can see is that they do very sensible things, right? They connect pieces in order to create four in a row eventually. But what you might also see is that this is pretty complex, right? This is not a very easy game anymore. And you actually have to think ahead multiple steps in order to do well on this. The coloring that you can see on top of this board is the result of a computational model that we built of human play. So that's mostly what my lab does. We try to predict what people do using computational models. And computational models are useful because they allow you to dissect the components of a very complex mental process. And so you can say, okay, people are internally, while they're thinking about their next move, they're trying to build something like a decision tree. And then this decision tree has certain features and it has a certain depth. And then you can try to fit that kind of model to individual subjects' behavior. So after you do that, and I'm just going to play this movie again, you essentially get a prediction map. So if it's a very bright red, that means a very strong prediction. And the model is successful if it can predict where the person is actually moving, right? And our model isn't always right, right? So very often you see people move at a location where that is not bright red. That means that the model didn't make a very strong prediction there for that location. But in some cases, it is actually pretty good, like here, right? And overall, we achieve about 41% correct with this model. And that might not sound like a lot, but if you just think about how many possibilities there are in this game, every move you can play at many different locations, it's actually something that we're pretty happy about, right? If you just look at chance, that would be only 4% correct. If you're interested and you want to actually try this yourself, just take a screenshot right now, because you can go to this website and play against the computer and see how well you are doing with this game. Now, how do we use this to study scientific questions? Well, first of all, we compare against other models of human planning, so we can contrast different theories with each other. We can also predict response times because our models predict like how big of a decision tree somebody is going to build. And it's not always the same. Sometimes it's harder and you can build a bigger tree. And then the prediction is that people are going to think longer. We predict where they look because our model also tells you where you should be paying attention. We predict mouse movements. That's sort of the same idea that people tend to hover their mouse over where they're thinking of moving. We study the effects of expertise. So this is sort of a classic question in psychology, right? Like what really changes when you get better at something? And we can do this with this task and with this model in hand. We can characterize what is getting better. Now, in collaboration with a developmental lab, we are studying planning in children. So what gets better between 8-year-olds and 24-year-olds as they are playing this game? We have other collaborations where we study the neural basis of planning. So how is, for example, value and decision tree search represented in the brain? And finally, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about a big online data set. We do this in collaboration with a company called Peak. And they have an iPhone app where they programmed our game. And it looks different. You see that it looks different, but it's the same game. It's just with more pictures and more flashes and sounds, etc., just to make it fun to play. And we collected data in collaboration with them for about a month and a half. And over that period of time, we got a total of almost 11 million games and about 159 million moves to analyze. So the poor graduate student who's analyzing this will probably never finish his PhD, but this is sort of a rich source of real-world data. Now, you can argue that playing a game on your phone is not real-world, but for many people these days, it is the real world. Just briefly about another project. So the previous presentation mentioned procrastination. We also do a little bit on that. So there's a bit of connection between different labs here. We have people do a very boring reading task, and they have to spread their work over 7 days. And we are particularly interested in the gap between what they're planning to do and what they actually do. So it's called the intention behavior gap. And this is an example of what we asked in the beginning, like how many paragraphs of this really boring reading task do you plan to complete on each of these 7 days? And then we compare to what they actually do in the end. So it's also a very real world planning task. Now, if you're not only interested in psychology, but also in data science, math, computer science, then the kind of work that my lab does and several other labs in our department do might be of interest to you. And we often operate under the header of computational cognitive science. It's essentially the study of intelligence, learning, and thought using mathematical models and computer simulations in addition to human behavior experiments. So if you're interested in that direction, combining psychology with those methods, then you may want to check out this website and these labs. That's all. Thank you. And I'm taking any questions.
Sure thing. We have time for about one question before Professor Ma will turn to the chat to help answer those questions. As Professor Ma highlighted at the end, there's a lot of support if you're interested in understanding statistical modeling, big data. That's a term that maybe you've heard in your trajectory, your academic trajectory so far. And there's lots of ways that students are finding support for getting the skills that they need to handle that kind of data within our department, within collaborations we have with other departments. It's really and with Facebook and Google just as our next door neighbors, there's lots of opportunities for training in that.